inspire us in our several callings to do the work which thou givest us to do with singleness of heart.
I want to talk to you to begin with this morning about the subject of climate change. Now, I realize that this is a difficult political subject and that there are people on the political right who think that there is no climate change going on and are worried about the economy and the effects of all this talk about it. And I realize there are people on the left who are also promoting perhaps too much, as some people think, the idea of climate change, but trying to warn about what is going to happen. But the climate change I want to talk to you about happened several millennia ago, which we hear about in our scriptures today. And that is the flood at the time of Noah. This dramatic story, which we hear the last part of in our lesson today, of new beginning, new life, new hope, and new covenant. Now, I don't know about some of you, but I cannot think of the story of Noah without thinking of Bill Cosby's little riff on it. And it perhaps enters into your minds as well. I can't even begin to do it like Bill Cosby did, but you remember sort of the picture of Bill doing the dialogue himself, but he's standing there and suddenly hears this voice, Noah! And he sort of shudders and things like that, and the voice says, I want you to build me an ark. And Noah says, what's an ark? God explains to him, and he says, and I want the ark to be 300 cubits in length, 50 in width, and 30 cubits high. What's a cubit? And on the dialogue goes until finally Noah begins to ask why he should be the one who has to do all this and do all this work. And then the rain starts to fall, and the voice of God comes back to him and says, Noah, how long can you tread water? And at that point, Noah gives in and decides that he will build the ark for the Lord. Well, it's a wonderful story, legendary story, but a story about new hope and new covenant, new birth. Never will the world be flooded again. Humans are to live there in turn by God's ways and to share this planet. The words that we hear in the book of Genesis that we are to till and to keep. We are to use the good things that God has given us, but also to keep them for others as well. And then in our gospel, of course, we have another remarkable story of new birth at the very beginning of Mark's Gospels. You know, sometimes we recognize that we are living in challenging times, but the time Mark's Gospel was written, it was a very challenging time too. I sometimes suggest to people that what we really have in Mark's Gospel are the cause of the writing of the Gospel, in a certain sense, are four deaths. There is, of course, the death of Jesus, which the Gospel seeks to help us to understand and to know God's purposes in. There is the destruction of Jerusalem, which probably has just taken place and probably has caused great concern among disciples and others. Now that Jerusalem is destroyed, wouldn't Jesus have returned by now? Why isn't Jesus returned? Why aren't we now in a state of glory now that this has happened? The third death is probably because the disciples themselves, the first disciples, are dying off. And they are not around to help us to understand and to remember directly their experiences of Jesus. And the fourth death is the death of the tradition that the disciples gave, in which the gospel was just told out. It didn't need to be written down. Now you and I think, well, gee, why didn't they write the gospel down right away? That's what they should have done. But they valued so much more hearing from the people who knew Jesus. And if they didn't hear from the people who knew Jesus, then they heard from the people who knew the people that knew Jesus. Now it was a time, there's a certain sadness in this, when, if you will, the gospel needs to be written down. So Mark wants to explain wants to tell us, wants us to understand. It's a dramatic gospel. And as you probably remember, this is the gospel, the shortest of the gospels, which doesn't begin with a birth narrative. We don't hear about Joseph and Mary and Bethlehem and Nazareth and so forth. We don't get that in the story. Instead, Jesus sort of leaps upon the stage. He is there, present, proclaiming the kingdom of God. But first we have his baptism. And again, a dramatic story. In Mark's gospel and Matthew and Luke's gospel, the heavens are opened. But in Luke's gospel, the Greek word suggests they're ripped open. It's almost a big noise that takes place. The space, as it were, between earth and heaven is opened up. And one hears the voice of God at the baptism proclaiming, this is the birth, if you will, of Jesus, the ministry of Jesus, proclaiming that this is his beloved. This is the Son of God. And now we are to hear and to listen to him. And Jesus is God's beloved and chosen, comes forth to proclaim the new kingdom of God, to heal, to exercise, to sometimes create controversy as he does so with others, and to die, and then to be raised again. But one of the other remarkable things about Mark's gospel, and one of the reasons he's writing, is he wants us to understand that although Jesus is risen, he hasn't appeared yet. He hasn't come back again. There is, as it were, no glory yet. We have to live, as it were, in difficult times. We have to join Jesus. We have to go in his way. Now, I don't know about you, but I, as a Christian, am sort of more interested in the glory part than I am sometimes in the suffering part, or picking up my cross, or denying myself, or following the servant way, becoming like a little child, being a servant. It seems so different and so contrarian in many ways from the ways of the world. But Mark wants us to know that that's what we are to do now. And he uses that story. You remember the story about James and John? They're like me, I guess. They come to Jesus and they say, okay, we'd like to know when you get into your glory that whether we can, you know, be there with you. In fact, we'd like to be pretty important people there. We'd like to be in your right hand and your left hand at your time of glory. And Jesus explains to them that that time will come. But it's not to his, up to him to who will be in the right and the left hand. And he sort of dismisses that. That shouldn't be your concern. But rather now, are you able to drink the cup that I drink and be baptized with the baptism with I am baptized? He's obviously referring to his own suffering and death. They think they can, but can they really? Can you and I really? Is the question that is being asked. Can we share in that path of Jesus? And he sums it up by saying, for the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve. And we are asked if we are able to join in that path with Jesus. As we come to think about our own baptisms, our own renewal, our own time together in service with Jesus. The kingdom of God, Jesus says, has drawn near. Repent and believe in the gospel. That repentance is not so much a sorrow for things we've done wrong in the past, although that could be part of it. But it is a new hope, a new promise, this new time that God has given for us to live in. But it is a time of service. It is a time in which we seek to follow Jesus' ways instead of, if you will, the ways of the world, which would sometimes say, well, the most important thing is for you to succeed, for you to get things, for you to be number one. Rather, it is to follow Jesus in his way of living for others. This beginning of Lent, you and I want to, no doubt, think about those ways again, the ways of our renewal, the ways not only as individuals, but the way we together may begin able to share in these servant ways of Jesus. And so we think about, well, maybe there are some things that we can give up or maybe better take on during Lent. I always love this story of the mother who asked her little 6 or 7 year old boy after he'd heard a sermon like this what he was going to give up for Lent. And the little boy thought for a minute and he said, Pajamas. I'll give up pajamas for a minute or something. It's probably a good, careful answer. I don't know what the mother responded to that. But whatever we do, obviously the goal of it is to renew, to deepen our own understanding of our faith, to deepen our own understanding, if you will, of our own baptism. Always interesting to think about baptism. It's got so much symbolic significance to it, doesn't it, with the water. The water, in one hand, we tend to sprinkle, of course, but if you go down to the river or put into the water and things like that, you have some sense that the water is also dangerous. There is a certain sense of dying in the water, isn't there, in order that one can be reborn. If you are ever out in the lake, out in the river, and a storm comes up or something, you're reminded often how dangerous the water can be. But that water is also symbolic of being washed and cleaned and renewed and strengthened. Think for a moment, actually, about a time in your own life when maybe you were without water for a while. Maybe you were dirty and finally and sweaty and finally got a nice shower or something like that, and you felt all cleaned and sort of refreshed and renewed, or desperately thirsty and needed a drink. It often comes to my mind when I was a younger man. I used to love to go canoeing in a great provincial park north of Minnesota, and take my sons and take other people with me. We had great times up there. And sometimes you had to portage. It'd be a warm day, and maybe you'd have to portage the canoe. And some of those older canoes were pretty heavy. Excuse me, and portage them for as much as a mile. And you might go through a swamp. The bugs were kind of biting you, and you're all hot and bothered and so forth. And then the last stretch, I sort of think about, you'd go up a hill. We had to be very careful. There were a lot of rocks and things like that. And then you'd get to the top of the hill and start down. And between the birch and the pine trees, you could see the lake out there. And you could see and almost feel the coolness that would be there. You couldn't run yet because you're not with a canoe on your back. You had to go slowly. But I would get down there, and instead of setting the canoe down gently, I would, sometimes being so hot and bothered, I'd just go straight into the lake with the canoe right on my back, and then flip the canoe off my back, and then thrust myself in the water and drink some of the water and refresh myself. Well, baptism is supposed to be sort of like that. We gain new strength, we're renewed for life. How many of you remember when you were baptized? Okay, that's pretty good. How many people do, actually? Partly because we were probably very little. I remember when I was getting closer to being ordained a priest, I suddenly said to myself, well, maybe I ought to know something about my baptism. And so I went to my mother and asked her, I was baptized, wasn't I, mother? Said, oh, yes. Well, when was I baptized? We were very young. Within the first few, I can't remember exactly, but the first few weeks. So I called up the church where I was baptized, a church in the south side of Chicago. And fortunately, they'd kept the records, and they looked it up and said, oh, yes, you were baptized on Easter Eve in 1938, the 16th of April. I said, that's good, but of course I was almost 3 years old then. I went back and told my mother. I said, you waited a little bit long. But we probably may not remember, but we do remember thinking about our baptism from time to time. And now's not a bad time to do that again. Think about the renewal that we are called to do. How do we bring the kingdom of God on earth? Well, we do it as people who have been reborn, have been renewed, who've joined, if you will, in Jesus' baptism, who have become a new people, and have made these promises that we make in the covenant of our baptism, the vows that we make, not just again as individuals, but as a people of God together. You don't have to do this, but if you want to, you can even look at your Book of Common Prayer on page 304 and 305, and maybe sometime during Lent, you will want to go back and look at those vows and say, where am I now? To renounce evil. We say that if we're going to renounce all the powers of evil and wickedness in our world, wow, what a promise that is. There is so much evil and wickedness in our world, isn't there? There's the powers of greed. You know, greed feeds on our anxiety. Our anxiety is that we're somehow going to run out. We're not going to have enough in this world. We're not going to have enough money, I guess, or maybe even enough food. And the advertising in our world, of course, I'm not blaming them necessarily. It's the way of the world, but it feeds upon that, doesn't it? You deserve a break today. Look what you can get. Look what other people have. Look at the cars that they have. Look at the vacations they're taking. Look at the all the food that they have and so forth. You better get yourself some of that. And we get anxious that other people are getting more than we are. And that greed, that power of evil, causes us to want to deny doing some of the things, the sharing, the living more simply, the things that we know that we would like to do, that we would like to be able to be in our world, that we could serve others better. But that force is there. One of the things that probably does cause, whether you believe in climate change or not, but causes all the environmental degradation and things in our world, because the tendency is to use it up and not to try to save it for others. Be sure that we're getting our share. Those forces of evil are strong in our world. They create wars. They create a lot of the evil that is done on our behalf. Sometimes when we confess our sins, we confess those sins done on our behalf, the wrongs done. And we say, well, I wish that wouldn't happen. But it wouldn't happen if there weren't all the forces of greed and evil and wrong in our world. Well, what's a strong thing to say that we're going to renounce them? We're going to repent. We're going to turn away from those things in new hope, in a new life of service. And we're going to do that by sharing together in our faith, in the bread, sharing in the apostles' teaching, hearing our gospels, learning how to share that with one another. And then we're going to try to live it out in our lives by being the kind of people who will work for justice, for rightness and fairness. That's a tough one too. What is right and what is fair? One thing we're debating in our political life right now about what is fair. Should everybody be able to have health care in our world? Should everybody be able to have enough food to eat? Should there be enough to go around? Can we somehow be a people who live like that so that we can do that with others? How would we do that? And we debate about the best ways in which to do that, but that we should do that, that we are called to do that. Those ways of rightness and fairness, there in our promise, our baptismal vows. And that we will seek to love our neighbor as ourselves. Not just putting ourselves first, but actually sharing in this world, being a generous kind of people. You know, I often have it's difficult for me, I don't know about you, but to actually picture Jesus. Just try to see Jesus' face. Maybe we're not supposed to. The Gospels don't tell us what he looked like. But I often have a picture of him with his arms out. His arms out to those in need, those in spiritual need, those in physical need, those in need of healing, to the lepers, to blind Bartimaeus, to rich tax collector Zacchaeus, to Mary Magdalene, to others of the poor, to others who felt rejected, to others who thought maybe they weren't going to be accepted. His arms out to them in forgiveness and acceptance and love. And then I say to myself, well, I'm supposed to live that way too. Aren't we all supposed to live that way and to do that kind of sharing, arms out with others? To be that kind of a generous people? No, I don't want to live like this. I mean, the world threatens me, so maybe I really better protect myself from other people. And I begin to want to live that way, but then I hear Jesus call, and I want to live like this. Somebody once said that people all wrapped up in themselves make pretty small packages. Well, I don't know about you, but I don't want to be a small package if I want to follow Jesus. So arms out, and then to respect the dignity of every human being. What a phrase that is. A poor person, a person of another religion, a person of another race, a person of another gender, a person of another orientation. whoever they may be, they are God's children. They and their dignity should be part of my concern, to respect that and to offer them dignity in life. Well, that's a real calling, of course, but that's what we are called to do, the way we are called to live, to be Jesus to others in our world. I sometimes tell people the story. I've always remembered this. I was a very young priest in a church just outside Chicago. John, you remember. And we still called on people in their homes. It's still a good thing to do, but most of the mothers were at homes with small children then and so forth. And so I was assigned to go around. I had a book that had the addresses of everybody, and I would go around to these homes. It was in the summertime. It was a warm day, I still remember. And I came and rang the doorbell, and the door opened, and there was a four-year-old boy standing there who I knew from church and who obviously recognized me. I had my collar on. And he just stood there. I could hear the mother sort of in the back. She was probably in her shorts cleaning or something like that, and didn't know they'd want to come to the door and see the priest or whatever. But anyway, the little boy's just looking at me, eyes big as saucers. And he says, "Mom, Jesus is here." Of course, my kid came in and said, "Well, I'm not Jesus." But I got in the car and went back, and I said, "Well, not just because I'm a clergy person, but because I'm a Christian, yeah, we are called to be Jesus in one way or another." Wonderful Desmond Tutu says that we all bear the reputation of Jesus in our hands. In this world today, we are oftentimes the gospel to other people in the way that we live, in the way that we share, in the way that we care. People may not know anything about Christianity, but they may know that you are a Christian and that therefore you bear something of Jesus' love and Jesus' spirit of service, Jesus' spirit of care in our hands. We are, I like to remind myself and each other, we are, in Paul's phrase, meant to be ambassadors of that love of God in Jesus, that reconciling love of God, of Jesus in our world. What a thing to be. You know what an ambassador is? The ambassador of the United States of America to Indonesia goes to Indonesia and tries to represent the best of the United States to Indonesia. Who we are, who we want to be as a people, all our values, democracy. Well, we are ambassadors of the reconciling love of God in Jesus. Think of yourself as that, as you go forward in your daily life, in your life with others, your life with family, life with the community, life at work, life in service, that you can be, we all can be together, ambassadors of that way of God on earth, following Him. And I suppose, you know, I say to myself when I see all the wrong and the evil in our world and have all my concerns and all my doubts, why else be a Christian? Maybe when we get together in the education hour, we can talk a little bit more about that. What does it mean to be an ambassador, to offer the reconciling love of God in our world? That's what we are called to be. What an honor to be those baptized Christians who are called with Jesus to be servants and to be the ambassadors of God's reconciling love in the world. Amen.
Son of God, we beseech thee to hear us.
Son of God.